In this screencast, I'm going to demonstrate the hypergeometric distribution. I'm going to derive the probability function for it, and I'm going to go through an example. So the hypergeometric distribution is used oftentimes when we have sampling without replacement. A lot of times this is the case when we have a small population or we have destructive sampling. Now, if you have a really big population and you remove samples from it without replacement, the population is so big that removing a small sample doesn't really do anything to the characteristics of the population. So that you would use the binomial distribution. So the hypergeometric distribution is when you have some sort of population of limited size. And let's just say that that's capital N. Of the capital N items, we have capital K that have some sort of characteristic. And I'm going to refer to K as being a success, although in some cases you could turn this around and say K is really a failure. So we have K and we have N minus K. So those combined give us our capital N, which is some sort of limited size population. Now we take a sample from this, we assume it's mixed up, and that sample is going to have little n items, and the number of successes in that sample will denote by little x. This is oftentimes used when trying to answer a question like, what is the probability that the sample of size little n has x successes? This is used a lot in product testing. So I'm going to start the derivation of the hypergeometric sequence by noting that the probability of having x successes in a sample of size n, so n will be set by the user, and also x will be chosen, but the function is going to be a function of x, is the number of ways that satisfy a particular constraint divided by the total possibilities. So the number of ways that satisfy a constraint. Now, our sample is going to be composed of a certain number of successes and a certain number of failures. And if we multiply these two together, for every possible combination of successes with every possible combination of the failures, then that will be the number of ways that satisfy a constraint. And now we're saying that we have x successes, so this here is going to be x. The number of failures then is going to be the number of items in the sample minus the number of successes. We have k successes in our population. So if I go back here to our diagram, so we have k successes in our population of big N. So how many ways can we put k successes that are possible, so k possibilities, into x spots? It's just k choose x. If we had 20 successes in our population of 100, and our sample is going to have 3 successes, that'd be 20 choose 3. There are that many ways to combine the k successes in our population into x number of spots. Now what about failures? How many ways, remember we have n minus k possible failures in our population, and we're going to put that into little n minus x spots. So how many different ways can we combine n minus k failures in the population into n minus x spots? It's just a combination. So for each of these successes on the left, we can multiply that with each of these failures on the right. So to calculate the total number of ways to satisfy the constraint, it's just the product of these two. Now remember, probability was the total number of ways that we can satisfy a constraint divided by the total number of possibilities. The top of this is going to be k choose x times big N minus big K over n minus x. But the denominator is the total number of ways that we can take capital N items and put them into little n spots, which is just big N, choose little n. So this is the probability function for the hypergeometric sequence. So I've got an example problem here. You work for a pharmaceutical company that produces a product called Curzol. The FDA arrives and they want to do a random check. They want to test a week's worth of production. In a week, your company makes 20 batches. They're going to take 5 of them, and this is going to be a destructive test. So it's a sampling without replacement. Your internal testing during the week has indicated that 17 of the 20 batches are good. What is the probability that at least 4 of the 5 batches tested are good? First of all, whenever you see at least, that is sort of a cue that you're going to be using the sum of two different probabilities. So at least would mean you have 4 or 5. So this is really what I'm asking for is F of 4 plus F of 5. We have our population of 20 batches, and we know that 17 are successful. So I'm going to say K then is equal to 17, and big N is equal to 20. Now the FDA comes and they take a random sample of 5 items. So little n is equal to 5. What's the probability that 4 or 5, so X equals 4 or 5, are successful? So we can just plug these values into the hypergeometric function here. When you do that, you would get F of 4 is equal to about 0.46, and you get F of 5, which equals about 0.40. So the total probability that at least 4 of the 5 batches tested are good is 86%. Now let me show you how to do this in Microsoft Excel. I've set this up in Microsoft Excel. I have my big N, and I'm going to label this big N. I have a big K here. That's the number of successes in our population, and big N is the number of total batches. This is going to be little n, n bar. This is the number of successes in our sample of size 5. This is 4 or 5. In Microsoft Excel, there is a function, hypergeom.dist, and this returns the hypergeometric distribution. So the first thing here is the sample successes. So sample S is the sample successes. So that's going to be 4. The number in our sample was 5, so that was N bar. The next thing is the successes in our population. We have big K successes in our population. The number in our population, we have big N. And this is going to be false because we're not doing a cumulative distribution here. So this is going to determine the probability that we get in our sample of size 5, we get exactly 4 successes, and that's 46%. And I can drag this down, and we get about 40. And then I can just sum those two, and that's what we got using the formula, about 86%. Same thing we get using this formula, because this is the exact formula that Excel is using.